Okay, good morning, colleagues. Welcome to the third meeting of the Devolution Further Powers Committee. Can I remind members to please switch their mobile phones off or at least put them into a mode that we can't hear? We'll get straight on to business. Agenda item one is an evidence session on Scotland's fiscal framework and welfare powers. And I warmly welcome the witnesses to the meeting who we've heard of from before, but you know, always had good evidence sessions with Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics at University of Stirling, and Dr. Jim McCormick, the Associate Director of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. Welcome, gentlemen, and thank you for coming along this morning. Can I just kick off in the area of no detriment? I've been thinking about the potential of any future welfare changes from either the Scottish Government or the UK Government after the full package of the Smith proposals become law, and wondering in reality how workable they are, and particularly around the principle of no detriment and the principle two, which states that there should be no detriment as a result of either government's policy decision post-devolution. Is that really possible within the scope of the terms that it's meant, without, you know, areas for potential disagreement, and is it realistic? I just wanted a better feel for that, because I've had some evidence of it. I've not really got underneath it, though. So I don't know who would like to kick that off. David, Jim?
I'll kick off. I mean, the simple answer, I think, is that it's not possible to enact the second part, the second form of the no detriment principle without going into massively complex calculations with the huge potential around that for dispute between the different authorities. I mean, for example, the air passenger duty and Newcastle Airport impact is taken as a kind of classic example of how you end up tying yourselves in knots in trying to figure out what the impact on the rest of UK government would be should Scotland decide that it wanted to reduce its air passenger duty or eliminate the air passenger duty, because you've got to try to imagine what would have happened had Scotland not taken that decision. And it's around that question, which we call a counterfactual, that all of the uncertainty arises, because, you know, it didn't happen. So how could you know what would have happened had Scotland not taken the policy decision that it had, that it has taken? It really, you end up in a situation of, I guess, mainly economists arguing with each other about what the impact might have been had the decision gone a different way. And it's not clear that there's any easy way to resolve that without long, maybe not at all, but certainly it would involve long and complex calculations. So, I looked at the House of Lords work on this, and they interviewed a man from the IMF called Carlo Cottarelli, who said that there was no similar principle in operation anywhere else in the world. So, I mean, that's the basis for my argument that I think it's unworkable.
Jim?
I think the fact that we're in uncharted territory internationally, as David said, as we heard in the last session of the committee as well, is really significant. If we are to pursue this principle, I think it's really important that there are some really clear principles underlying it about transparency and, as far as possible, simplicity. So transparency is about working methods, so it's not about one government trying to pull the wool over the eyes of another government. Transparency and proportionality here. I mean, it cannot be the case that no detriment means that, you know, minor changes in budgets at the margins are given the same prominence as a very major incursion into, for example, tax territory. So income tax will be a shared tax base between the governments. So we have to understand that in a shared tax base, there could be quite substantial consequences of one government's actions versus another's actions. So I don't think we should give up on the principle. I think we just need to have some proportionality and be able to distinguish between very major detriment and more minor detriment, which may in fact net off each other, plus and minus either side of the border. So I'm in favour of shining a light upon what appear to be the major risks and perhaps benefits for each government, building expertise to understand those major budget consequences, which, as I say, come from both tax decisions as well as welfare spending decisions, potentially. And you know, build up our data and evaluation around those more major areas rather than fretting around every potential consequence in our budgets.
Could I just add too that, I mean, I agree with Jim on that point, and I think, you know, if there was a major a decision about the size of the state which had a major impact on, let's say, Scotland's block grant, so the rest of the UK decides that the health service should be privatised, that would have a major consequence for Scotland's block grant. At that point, I think you want to have something kicking in to negotiate, you know, well, you know, what are the implications of this for Scotland's funding and going through that. And it does kick into what you probably will also want to discuss later on, how the block grant is adjusted and how it might, the way that it might be adjusted could change in the light of these kinds of decisions.
Well, I'm certainly going to come, and Malcolm certainly wants to ask questions about block grant adjustment. Before I get there, I think that plays in, David, to something you said in pages 11 and 12 of your written evidence, where you say, that if attendance allowance in England was to be devolved to local authorities, there would be no relevant data on which to calculate Scotland's block grant adjustment for this benefit. So therefore, are either of our witnesses today aware of any proposals to change the structure in England of benefits that are proposed for the devolution that could have that kind of impact? Because there's a sort of area, I think, that would be a big change.
This is purely hearsay that I've heard when I've been down south, that's all. But I mean, it is true that local government social care budgets in England are extremely cash-strapped, and you know, the government might be making a case to transfer some of the disability benefits budgets into the local government budgets to build up their social care support. Then I guess it becomes a little bit like council tax benefit, which I mentioned in my paper as well. You know, that has been devolved down to the local authority level in England. And what has happened there is that the local authorities can no longer identify that part of their grant from central government which is associated with the payment they got for council tax benefit. If the same thing happened around attendance allowance, there really would be very little to compare Scotland's attendance allowance.
So how could we go about, if that was to happen, how could we go about, if there's no data, being able to adjust the block grant appropriately? Would there be a way?
The only thing that occurs to me is that you could. It's another thing that I mentioned in the paper is that you might index to the so-called at-risk population, so you have estimates of how many pretty severely disabled people there are, because that attendance allowance covers that kind of condition in Scotland as against the rest of the UK, and how are these two moving relative to one another. That would be a relatively objective way to assess the potential for attendance allowance claims. But of course, claims behaviours differ. It's not just disability that matters. Who claims and how they claim, whether they're encouraged to claim, also makes a difference as far as you know, the the ultimate cost to your budget is concerned.
Yeah, but I think the bottom line is you're saying if DWP decide to do this, it's just going to make it more complicated in terms of sorting out Scotland's block grant. That's going to be inevitably the situation. I think it's something we need to be aware of in terms of when we draw a report up, so I'm glad we'd be able to draw it. Jim, do you want to make any comment on that?
I think we can perhaps anticipate over the next 5 years an interest in Treasury and DWP to move further in the direction of localisation of some benefits in England. How far that goes is, of course, unknown, but you can detect a broad interest in doing that. A complicating factor as well is variable localisation with some cities in England having a different deal from the rest of local government in England, and perhaps even city deal in Scotland having a different relationship with Treasury as well. So the picture that emerges is one of genuinely variable geometry or variable deals, if you like, for different tiers of government. And the only way through that, I think I agree with David, is to look at aggregation factors affecting potentially eligible populations, whether by age or based on historical data. And it certainly means we need to be using, 3 to 5 year rolling averages rather than cashing out in a single year.
Go to see that bit again, will you, please?
So measuring populations that may be eligible and the budgets attached to them, but over running averages of 3 to 5 years, not taking a single baseline year as, the best indicator we've got. This is about indexation only in the future. It's really important that we have those broad rolling averages as our measurements, because they can help to incorporate, changes in data from year to year, which are perhaps not typical.
Just to add, if we do go down that route, and it seems a sensible route, you've got to have the data that to provide that. And I was discussing this issue of data yesterday in a presentation. In 2001, the Labour Force Survey, which does actually collect some disability and health-related information, had a sample of 10,000 each quarter in Scotland. Now it's down to 6,000, just over 6,000 a quarter. So there needs to be some kind of guarantee that the data, if you go down this route at looking at eligible populations, is adequate, and that you don't spend your time worrying about the quality of the data when big decisions are being made.
Okay. I know that Linda wants to ask questions later about individual detriment areas, but before we go there, I think it probably naturally flows into the block grant adjustment at this stage from that discussion, because obviously we're going to have some method if we're not going to go into individual negotiations of adjusting that block grant adjustment. Malcolm, I think you had some questions.
That was really interesting. I think the theme of your presentations there is the complexity of this, and it could become more complex because you're talking about attendance allowance, but that's been skewed in Scotland because of the free personal care issue that we all remember. And in terms of the changing populations, I suppose it was interesting because I asked this question last week, and I don't know if you've seen the official report from last week, but David Phillips of the Institute of Fiscal Studies just sort of cut to the chase in a kind of way, and I assumed that, the method that has achieved a certain amount of consensus for tax in terms of per capita index deduction would not be applicable to Social Security, and he kind of surprised us by saying, just use it because, if you try and do something else, there are all sorts of problems attached to it. So, David Bell, you did mention this, and interestingly, you pointed out in your paper that per capita index deduction wouldn't work so well for us. It's the opposite of income tax, so index deduction would be better. But I suppose the question, cutting through all that, is it reasonable for us? It's understandable for us that we just want the best deal for both, but given the difficulties we will have to get our desired objective for income tax, is it then reasonable that we work out some complex method that's going to give us the best deal for Social Security? Well, perhaps it's understandable and reasonable, but is it that risky or that bad just to go for the per capita index deduction for Social Security in the same way as for income tax?
I think there is a question about the deal which will be done and whether in order to get a deal done, a simple deal is done. And if a simple deal is done, what will happen is that one of these methods will be chosen and it will apply across the tax and welfare horizon. And in those circumstances, as far as Scotland's concerned, it's more important to get a good deal on the tax side than it is on the welfare side, just because of the, you know, there's 11 billion in income tax alone, and what we're talking about here is around 2.5 billion. So you're going to be around, the costs are going to be greater overall for the Scottish budget if the income tax deal is less beneficial as far as Scotland is concerned. And that would, of course, just take away all of the issue that we've been discussing about indexing on relative populations at risk and so on. So it's a question. Partly, it's a question of what risks are being shared across the UK as a whole, and what risks are not being shared. Really, if you focus on the tax block grant adjustment, what you're saying is that the risk that you're looking at is Scotland performing economically at a different level to the rest of the UK. If you go for indexation of wealth, so that's the risk you don't cover with the income, the way the block grant adjustments that are being proposed for income tax. If you go for indexing the welfare separately, what you're saying is that actually the UK is willing to cover changes in population or changes in disability in Scotland, because the grant to Scotland would increase if Scotland became relatively more disabled. In other words, it would have an insurance policy against increases in disability. And of course, none of that was the issue of these kinds of principles was never ever set down as the negotiations went on through the various stages and indeed in the bill. So we're kind of left scrabbling around now trying to figure out which things it would be better to share at the UK level in terms of what Scotland would get out of it, and which would be better not to share. So that's a very long-winded answer to your question, but I mean, I think my basic point is that if a simple deal has to be done, then the focus has to be on the taxpayers rather than the welfare payers.
Are you coming in on that or not? I suppose, going back to your own initial thoughts on relative populations at risk, I suppose one of the arguments that's used against that is it takes away the incentives in terms of the relationship between disability and health, but that may be marginal since a lot of people with disabilities, that's difficult. But I suppose the other thing is the distribution across the population. Can we predict this for the future? Because, I mean, you say, David Bell, the main client group for the welfare benefits being transferred to Scotland is older people. I mean, is that in fact the case? Because the biggest benefit by far being transferred is disability living allowance, which is people under 65. So is it in fact older people, unless you've got rather a broad definition of older people?
The disability living allowance is awarded based on your age at the time of your claim. But if subsequently you pass the age of 65, you will continue to receive disability living allowance. So, no, disability living allowance.
Do you?
Yeah.
I thought it became attendance allowance at 65.
No, it doesn't become attendance allowance. That is, the attendance allowance is paid to those aged over 65 who become in need of personal care subsequent to reaching pension age. Disability living allowance can be paid to those who are aged, can only be paid initially to those aged under 65, but if they, in the course of their claim, go over the age of 65, then they continue to receive disability living allowance. And I think one of my graphs shows that, you know, the majority of claimants of disability living allowance have been claiming for a very, very long time. So quite a big proportion of them are aged over 65.
About one third of the budget by budget terms.
Because it has been suggested before, I think you're suggesting it, you know, you could index it to the elderly population, and people have this view that the elderly population in Scotland as a percentage of the population is increasing more in Scotland than other. I think there's some controversy about that. But anyway, so you could argue if it is skewed, as you're saying, to older people, that you could use the numbers of older people, or would that... You know, because it's going to be difficult to get the specific information you want about the relative population at risk. You've said that yourself, and that's, you know, that's. But you would, I mean, would that actually be your ideal method? If you could actually have an accurate assessment of the relative population at risk, you would use that and just keep updating that every few years. Would that be your ideal scenario?
Yeah, I mean, that's the ideal insurance policy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't provide you with the incentive necessarily, as you mentioned yourself, around, you know, introducing public health measures to reduce the level of disability in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. But if you want to be covered, to get adequate money from Westminster to cover the current population of disabled people in Scotland, then you should look for one of those kind of objective.
And to what extent would the number of older people be proxy for that, or would that give a quite different...
I'm not sure that it's all that good. I think you might want to fine-tune it a bit. I mean, so Scotland's share of attendance allowance payments has been falling at the same time as apparently Scotland, its elderly population relative to the rest of the UK has been growing. So there's something down underneath going on there. I show, for example, that the number of claims related to frailty have suddenly dropped off. That number of attendance allowance claims related to frailty.
Is that partly because of older people in care homes, or is that marginal impact?
The population in care homes in Scotland hasn't changed at all since the free personal care legislation was introduced. So it's not that, I don't think.
But they're disqualified from attendance allowance, so presumably that you would have to take account of them.
Yeah, these will be people at home, living at home.
I'll just add that the picture is different for each of the benefit areas being devolved. So for attendance allowance, the population measure is a very good measure. For DLA PIP, it's a very partial measure. We only look at over 65s for the reasons that we've been discussing. On incentives, it's really important to keep hold of that principle and map out where can we build in incentives to get the benefit of our investment in Scotland. And again, it looks different across different areas. And we should add in, perhaps we'll come on to it later, the importance of employment programmes, income tax revenues, so that in earlier adulthood, we are building in, you know, proper support for people to be in better health, working, which flows through long term into how people reach older age. And just on demography and Scotland's place, I mean, Wales has the oldest population structure in the UK. Northern Ireland has the youngest, along with London. Scotland is at the older end of the spectrum. But many parts of the UK, leaving aside the extremes, are converging over the next 30 years. That's before we build in migration assumptions. So I'm less confident in, you know, the view that we know how Scotland's share of the GB or UK older people share is going to look over time. We know how it looks now, we know how it looked in the past, we can do some short-term projections, but we have to be careful about some of our assumptions there, I think.
Okay, that was interesting, thank you.
Now, I think we've got two people who want to ask in supplementaries in this area, Mark and Stuart McMillan. Mark?
Yeah. Malcolm hasn't mentioned David Phillips of the Institute for Fiscal Studies, and last week he suggested that because welfare spending is an AME budget line, it would be easier to adjust for that than it is for the DEL budget lines. But listening to what you've been saying so far, It doesn't strike me that that's necessarily the case. What's your view on that?
I'm not quite clear what's going to happen. I looked at council tax benefit and what had happened in relation to that in England, and that's one instance where I know that money has gone from the AME budget and into the Del budget. So it's going into Del budget and then into local government individual budgets, and then becomes it's in competition with other parts of the local government budgets in England. So if they have a council tax benefit program that is very cheap, then they can spend more on education. Now, it's not clear to me as yet, although I was assuming that this would be the case, that this welfare budget would form part of a Del allocation to Scotland rather than an AME allocation. And in that case, you're then opening up this question of, you know, to what extent would you wish to redirect monies to, say, local authorities to support social care rather than to attendance allowance? David Phillips may have more information on this than me, but that, I mean, I think AME to Del conversions are not unknown, and the implication of that is that those budgets then are in contention with other parts of the Del budget.
Jim, do you have a...
It's a context point, which is the welfare cap is still something to watch, and we know that UK government has made a statement on you know, it can't be accountable, responsible for spending in Scotland on those benefits, but the welfare cap accounts in this financial year for well over half of all welfare spending, and even if UK government breaches its own target, as OBR thinks it will in three of the next 5 years, it's still an important bit of the Chancellor's thinking, and I think 8 or possibly 9 of the benefits to be devolved to Scotland are currently sitting inside the UK welfare cap. Now, I would just add that as a contextual point to watch, and it should be part of the negotiations of fiscal framework, even if it's easily resolved early on. It's something that may come back in future, and we should be alive to where that debate is going, I think.
Obviously, there's been well-documented evidence and coverage around take-up rate and the fact that a large amount of potential welfare spend goes unclaimed. I've called in the Chamber already for there to be a look at how benefit applications are handled and whether there are ways that could be simplified which might improve and increase uptake of benefit. Now, if that was to happen, how would you see that being factored in terms of block grant adjustment? Because obviously that flows from a policy decision rather than a situation at the point of devolution, but it would potentially have a material impact in terms of welfare expenditure relative to the rest of the UK.
The ideal position would be to have forecasting and outturn measures which are getting as close as possible to underlying eligibility for benefits, which are building in kind of incentives to raise take up over time. Take council tax reduction, which is already devolved. Our Scottish data and take up aren't good, but we can assume that we still have a problem. And if it's equivalent to the GB problem, we're talking about 1/3 of households in Scotland who should be entitled are not claiming council tax reduction. That's a major undershoot on what the budget ought to be. And you can do similar things across other benefits, both for working age and retirement, actually. So I'm in favour of over time, a fiscal framework that gets better at measuring what underlying eligibility should be, and then trying to close that gap in terms of take-up over time.
What's the likelihood of that? I mean, at the moment, we have a very clear ideological position at a UK level, which is looking to reduce the amount spent on welfare. That would tend to suggest that there would be less of an incentive to drive uptake of benefits and to ensure those who could take up benefits did so, because that would increase spend. So what's the likelihood of a UK government agreeing to a position which says, well, we'll account for you increasing uptake because we can then measure the number of people who should be getting benefits and account for the increased expenditure accordingly?
I think the likelihood is that more of the heavy lifting will be localised in England. So I think we'll see the UK government, insofar as they talk about take-up, they'll be talking mainly about budgets and capacity for local government to do most of that. The exception is universal credit. Universal credit, if we ever got to a position where this was rolled out with the right real-time information and the right kind of design principles, universal credit could substantially raise take-up because it is a basket of these benefits. So across those six bits of spending, which are currently separate, that's where the potential to substantially raise take-up lies, I think. In other areas, council tax reduction, Scotland already has the responsibility to raise take-up. I think we're well below what the budget should be for that. Other benefits will be reserved, and therefore the responsibility will lie with mainly with UK government, although we know that the evaluation evidence tells us that the most effective take-up campaigns tend to be face-to-face, local, through trusted intermediaries like housing associations and well-known charities. So, you know, that work doesn't come for free. So the goal of what needs to be done is very clear, I think, but achieving that through fiscal framework, that's long-term work that I think will never end, actually. But we should be at least starting in the right place and putting it on the table as an important principle, even if it takes a very long time to make progress.
And just adding, maybe David, you take a view on this, how often or how frequently do you think this needs to be subject to review in terms of the arrangements and how effectively they're working?
Well, I mean, if we're, we're seriously looking at some indexation towards the welfare powers, then take-up is a very important part of that overall picture that determines the budget at the end of the day. And I, you know, patterns change. The costs to individuals of applying for different benefits change over time. Some are difficult, some are much less difficult. Winter fuel allowance is almost, you know, and the state pension are almost 100% take up. And then you find other benefits which are more complex that people don't understand or are unwilling to go through the relevant tests in relation to. Then the take up rate drops quite substantially. I know some of my colleagues down south have done work on what are the factors that influence take-up rates, and maybe that's something we should be aware of. But it seems to me that it is such an important part of the determination of the overall budget that it's something you'd have to revisit on a fairly regular basis, because I don't see how you can forecast how it will change. We don't have the information in the first place about take-up rates, because we don't really measure eligibility all that well now. So how are we going to know where it will be in 5 years' time if we don't know where it is now?
The risk associated with this, I don't know whether it would be helpful to us if we could apply, you know, a proportionate test to some of the issues that we're discussing here, you know, when you, you know, on a risk register. If we apply the proportionality test that you referred to earlier, Jim, to this area and the level of risk here, and what, because I find it difficult to get you know, my head around some of this stuff about how, where are the really, really important areas and where is the big risk? Because if every issue is presented is very, very important, we lose our focus. And, you know, I think it's important for us as well when we finally get to a report to take up some of your caution about proportionality and risk here. So how important is this area in the scheme of things as a balance of risk for the ageing population, you know, which is still retained by the UK in terms of pensions, for instance? Where's the balance here?
I think we can say that the persistent problem of low take-up at working age and older people in Scotland, across the UK and the world, but in Scotland, it runs into hundreds of millions of pounds of unclaimed benefits to which people are probably entitled. So hundreds of millions of pounds. If you then compare that with, on the tax side, let's take the example of the UK government's plans to raise the personal allowance and other tax thresholds faster than inflation over the next 5 years. Those account for hundreds of millions of pounds being lost to Scottish revenue. So I would suggest those are major in terms of share of budget. Can I give you one more example, which is a much smaller sum of money, but it's very important for people affected, which is another test of impact. If low-income households in Scotland, as elsewhere, are going to lose universal credit income, for example, by scrapping off the work allowance for single people, that damages work incentives. It reduces incomes. It has a shunting effect potentially into the council tax reduction. As incomes go down, their eligibility for an ordinary devolved benefit goes up. Now, that's not probably a huge budget impact, but for the people affected, it could run into hundreds of pounds a year. So I think we need to assess the proportionality, which is about the global budget, and then some kind of understanding of what is the impact on households affected, even if those numbers are not huge by you know, share of the population.
Can I just tease that a wee bit more out before I go to Stuart McMillan? Because I think you mentioned tax allowance issues or tax-free personal allowances. Now, if the UK government plans to increase tax-free personal allowances to £12,500, and to raise the higher income tax threshold from £43,000 to £50,000 by 2021. What do you think would be the cost to the Scottish Government's budget of not implementing that change? Because that then becomes a real issue of policy difference.
I can go back and run my model and give you an answer to that question. I don't have it now. What I can't give you the answer to is how people will react. I gave evidence to the Finance Committee on this issue of behavioural responses to changes in taxes. So, if Scotland, you know, if the personal allowance goes up considerably relative to the rest of the UK, relative to Scotland and or the higher rate allowance, then how does that influence where people choose to work? We just don't know the answer to that question, and it's very difficult to speculate how that might be. And you know, this is a sort of second detriment effect. Yeah, second exactly. Detriment effect, and you know, a cautious government will end up tending to follow what the rest of the UK government is doing.
Before you go and do your modelling, just to get so we just get a feel of it. We're talking about hundreds of millions of pounds here again, in the way that Jim described, to happen. So this is substantial.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Just worth adding,
Jim. Convener, that GRF has supported IPPR to boost its tax benefit modelling to a much bigger sample size for Scotland. And we'll be reporting broadly in this area within the next few weeks, so hopefully in time to be helpful to your inquiry. And if you turn it round into a question of what could Scotland do with future powers to either mitigate or to take a different view from what future governments in the UK might do. Well, you know, we could choose to raise the basic rate limit with inflation rather than above inflation. We could choose to do the same for the higher rate threshold or even freeze it. These sound like quite minor adjustments, but they generate hundreds of millions of pounds of revenue. I'm not going to put a figure on it, but it is certainly in that territory. So by choosing not to raise faster than inflation, would be a really significant decision. And similarly, if we chose to raise tax thresholds at a higher rate than the UK government, then that, on the contrary, costs Scotland hundreds of millions of pounds. So I think for us to be very, very clear about the revenue consequences of tax allowance and threshold decisions in future, as well as welfare spending, there are two sides to this coin.
Luke Stewart, with your indulgence, I want to just tease this a wee bit further, because this is quite an important area, if you don't mind. Yeah. And I know Malcolm's got a tiny supplementary as well. Now, we're talking about welfare there, but what about the ability on the other side to raise tax and what that can do in terms of where we are? Because Spice have undertaken some modelling in this area of income tax that we could be raised in 2016, for instance, if 1p were added to the higher rate band of income tax. I mentioned that because I now want to compare these sums, what it might cost under some of the changes the UK government has made under its austerity policies. So could you make a stab at what that might cost to reverse some of the changes to universal credit, the disability benefits being devolved to Scotland, health, childcare funding, proposals not to implement that proposed income tax threshold that we're talking about? Are the numbers just big again? And if they are, what sort of timescales would these big numbers be over? Jim? How much tax would it raise as well?
I'd want to enter a huge cautionary note about estimates of changing the higher rate of income tax, because, first of all, we don't know enough about trends at that rate, trends in taxpayers and how incomes are holding up higher up. And we don't know enough about behavioural responses. I know that there are various models that try and estimate behavioural responses. I would be veering then towards the lower range of those estimates, I think the midpoint of a lower range of the estimates is around £75 to £80 million of additional revenue from 1p on the higher rate. 1p on the basic rate, where we can be a little bit less cautionary, I think the midpoint of the range is about £325 to £330 million. I'm talking in terms of ranges and midpoints deliberately, because I think to pick a figure is unwise. So that's about revenue raising. Decisions on basic rate limit and other tax thresholds can either raise revenue or take up revenue, depending on our choices. But these are, again, big sums of money in the context of, certainly compared to the £2.5 billion in the welfare budget that may be coming our way.
And on the other side, if we were to mitigate against some of the welfare changes, what sort of costs would we be talking about there?
I can give one example. Yeah. I've already mentioned abolition of the work allowance for single claimants within universal credit and for couples without children. So the debate has moved quickly from tax credit reductions and mitigation of those because of the autumn statement. I think that understanding the impact of abolishing the work allowance is probably the most urgent issue we now face in terms of universal credit. The risk is that by removing the work allowance, we start to undermine the purpose of universal credit. So without getting into that, we should be very concerned about work incentives in Scotland. But anyway, fully reversing the work allowance cuts in universal credit, again, it depends on how quickly we roll it out, but let's say we were fully rolled out by 2020 and all eligible singles and couples in Scotland were subject to that cut, then it's, you know, again, it's hundreds of millions of pounds. It's within the region of 200 to 300 million pounds cost of, so revenues lost and therefore cost of mitigation. Now, there's a whole other debate about the technical feasibility of mitigation, how you interact with HMRC, or actually DWP as it will be then, who will take over full responsibility of Universal Credit. And no doubt a cost to Scotland over and above the mitigation budget, a cost of using those systems and allowing variation in UK systems. But that's ballpark figure. I think the IPPR will give us a much more accurate figure within a few weeks.
Talking though, if it's hundreds of millions of pounds of yes. work allowance, although we're talking 3 pence and higher rate right away, effectively.
Yes.
That's a significant impact on taxation. Yeah. David, sorry.
No, I'm just going to agree that all of these estimates are subject to considerable uncertainty. You can turn the handle and figure out what the implications, if people didn't change their behaviour at all, what the effect on tax revenues would be. What we're not good at, and there's relatively little information on, is around what behavioural change they might make. And there's been, you know, we have to be a bit concerned about what high earners, how they respond, because they contribute such a big proportion of total income tax revenues. There is some work by Alan Manning at LSE on what the effect of the increase from the 45 to 50, or I've forgotten when it happened, the change in the additional rate as between 45 and 50. And it's not really very clear that an increase in rate added anything to total revenues. So you do have to be cautious, because you don't know what the behavioural response might be. And Jim says that's less of an issue down the income scale, where people maybe have less opportunities to find ways of avoiding tax.
Could I just add one follow-up point?
I'll need to move on to another area, Malcolm, after that. But when you go
really briefly, and we may want to come back to it later, there will be decisions also for Scotland around the basis upon which we choose to uprate devolved benefits over time. That's separate from indexing of the budget coming into Scotland, but a choice over how we then deploy those resources over time. Do we want to continue with a freeze in working age benefits? Do we want to link to inflation? Do we want to link to some measure of median earnings? Those are big choices which all have very big bandwidth in terms of the budget implications too.
Okay. Malcolm. And then
no, it was just obviously one of the 100 million you were talking about was the UK government raising the thresholds beyond inflation. I mean, are you confident that whatever version of block grant adjustment we get, that will be fully compensated for in terms?
Well, what would happen is that if Scotland is indexed to the growth in rest of the Scottish block grant adjustment is indexed to the increase in tax revenues in the rest of the UK, the tax revenues in the rest of the UK would increase by less, because you're adding to the personal allowance, so people are paying less income tax. As a consequence of that, the block grant adjustment would be smaller, which means that the amount taken out of Scotland's block grant from Westminster would be less. So Scotland would, in a sense, have less taken away from its budget due to the increase in the personal tax allowance south of the border.
So we shouldn't get too alarmed about that particular aspect, although it sounds alarming.
It does sound alarming, and I'm not entirely clear about the exactly how would pan out. Again, there are behavioural implications, but they're probably second order. In the first order, there would be some cover for the change.
Okay, thanks.
Stuart.
I'm keen to basically kind of establish your thoughts and opinions on the issue of the block grant adjustment and the no detriment to principle on the welfare powers that are to come to the Scottish Parliament. Bearing in mind, Smith recommended that the powers that were to come here, the Scottish Parliament to have the complete autonomy to determine the structure and value of the benefits or any new benefits or services which might replace them. And if at some point a future Scottish Government decided that it wanted to maybe scrap one of these devolved benefits and introduce something else, how do you think that would play out in terms of, the block grant adjustment, no detriment to, but also, as Dr McCormick reminded us of earlier, the fact that these benefits are included within the UK government's welfare cap?
That's a complicated question. I guess, you know, it will depend on the agreement. If the fiscal framework agrees a single mechanism for adjusting the block grant across taxes and across welfare, then the decisions that the Scottish Government might make in relation to welfare, although it might affect the welfare cap, presumably it can just make, you know, because the block grant adjustment would be indexed on basically on income tax revenues in the rest of the UK. Once you start fine-tuning down into the welfare indexing in relation to welfare powers, then you end up in the same problem that we started with if Scotland were to abandon one of its benefits, is the sort of mirror image to if the UK government decides to abandon attendance allowance, which is where, in a sense, that we started, and you end up with the problem of trying to compare what would have happened had you still got it. And that is a difficult one. And then we fall back on this question around can we just index to populations at risk, taking account of whether take-up is different as between Scotland and the UK and what allowance you might make for that. So in a way, although it's a complicated question, it is a sort of mirror image of this question of what the RUK government decides to do with its welfare powers. And ultimately, when we know the fiscal framework, which we hopefully will do in a week or two, we'll be able to come to a much better answer to the kind of question that you're seeking an answer for. We should know better then. But you know, if the structures change, as between Scotland and the rest of the UK, and you want to index on welfare powers, then you have to have some outside way of calculating what would have happened had the welfare powers not changed.
Yeah, I think it does make the argument for as clear and transparent an indexing formula as possible, which in principle would give Scotland maximum space to decide how to use those budgets without worrying about is there a consequence of scrapping or renaming or redefining a particular benefit. Also, some of these spend decisions kind of go together in families or clusters. So if you think about the way in which DLA or attendance allowance can act as a gateway to carers allowance, the fact that those three come together in Scotland is helpful because the consequences go in a loop, if you like, and they're internalised. There are other decisions that will spill over. So if Scotland made fundamentally different choices on DLA PIP to the rest of Britain, that may have a consequence for, I don't know, disability premiums with the universal credit, which is a UK budget line. So there will always be these internal and external spillover effects. On the point about who scraps what, maybe a kind of live issue is, in the autumn statement, the employment programmes, which were in the spirit of the Smith Commission, Work Programme, Work Choice, are all but being scrapped now. So what we thought were going to be particular budget lines with budgets attached to them, I think there's an 83% reduction projected around those budgets. So this is a live issue already before we even get into the detail of fiscal framework as a result of the Chancellor's decision. Now, you could then say, okay, those programmes are being all but abolished, the budgets are being fundamentally reduced, and Job Centre Plus, a UK-wide, GB-wide network, will take on some of those responsibilities. That should trigger a question, I think. Can we therefore track the total resources being spent on the same client groups that were intended for those programmes? And to what extent is there a grey area there around negotiating what is it exactly that's being devolved? Is it in the spirit of Smith and indeed the Scotland Bill? I think it's probably quite a good test case now as to how we answer your question.
Okay. I think it might be useful, convener, if we can maybe get Spice to maybe look into that a bit more for us as well, please.
I'm sure we can arrange for that to happen. Thank you. I'll come back to you and Boron later, Stuart, but I think Linda had a supplementary. You want to deal with the no detriment stuff for you while you're there?
Whatever you like, but I had a particular supplementary on what Jim just said. It was about the employability services. You know, the budget has been slashed, you know, as you've been talking about. And you mentioned Smith and the spirit of Smith. And, you know, it just strikes me that the difference now between what was agreed should be transferred and what is now likely to be transferred in terms of funding is massive, and would seem to me to be not allowing Scotland to take on the role that was agreed in the Smith Commission it should take on, even in the limited agreement by the UK government as to what should be passed over in employability services. And I wondered if you'd picked anything up, Jim, heard anything about how this was going to be managed. I know negotiations must be ongoing, but it would seem to me, to use the well-hackneyed word, that there's a great detriment both to the Scottish Government and indeed to people in Scotland as to what is now being transferred as opposed to what it was agreed would be in the spirit of the Smith Commission.
David and I were both at a Resolution Foundation event yesterday on trends in the Scottish labour market, where the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work was speaking on this very issue. So I'm sure this will be debated in the Scottish Parliament very soon. So the Smith Commission and the Scotland Bill, as amended now at the Lords, is very clear, I think, about which programmes and why. It doesn't, of course, talk about resource levels. That depends at the point at which you cash out the settlement and then try and index it. It just so happens that there's a major reduction in the budget attached. It's possible that will happen in future with other budget lines. I think it's important to keep hold of David's point about the intended eligible population. Work programme is going to be blended into a much broader health and employability support programme run generically through Job Centre Plus, as I understand it. So there may be a way of trying to calculate what does Scotland's broad share of support for the eligible population. The figure may be a bit bigger than the one that was simply attached to the figures announced in the autumn statement. I think it's important to make the point that this is not about, I think, views on the merits or otherwise of the work programme and work choice. I think the issue that's relevant to this discussion is high-performing welfare-to-work programmes based on international evidence can help to improve employment rates and work incentives, especially where the employment labour market's improving. That in turn can help with your income tax revenues and other consequences. And so this is not simply about what was the budget to be devolved, it's also about what's the knock-on effect for parts of Scotland with less strong labour market areas. What can the offer therefore be? I think there's also a consequence in Scotland for how we rationalise and improve the effectiveness of existing employability programmes run locally, which are for different client groups. But nonetheless, we have to have a sharper focus upon our existing powers, our existing budgets, and how effectively they're being deployed. That's a kind of, if you like, a separate but important consequence of this decision.
Would we, excuse me, just ask for a wee bit of clarification. How difficult will that be with the changes that have been made in terms of, you know, we always talked about it's not about the powers, it's about what you can do with them. I mean, where I come from has always been, we've not got enough power to be able to do what we'd want. It would seem to me that even since the agreement and the spirit of the Smith Commission, that we are reducing the powers in real terms about what you can actually do. Because already before transfer, we're having potential budget cuts in what was agreed at that point. And I know it's not all about money, but it does make a difference as to what you can actually achieve.
So if you come at this from the perspective of what are the outcomes for the intended participants and beneficiaries, we're looking at, let's say, something like 17 to 20% of the original budget prior to the autumn statement. We could probably turn that into 25, maybe even 30% of value for participants by trying to maximise what is devolved and also maximise the effectiveness of local employability programmes in Scotland. As an example, Fife has just conducted a major review of its employability services, and as a result, it's substantially improved job outcomes over the last 3 or 4 years. So I'm not going to say that we can't achieve much more, but this is a kind of ballpark figure. We could probably get back to about 25 or 30% of value and outcome for intended participants, but that is clearly one third of what we thought might be coming. So we are looking at probably a, well, the decision will be for Scotland, but I would imagine it will be about a much more targeted offer to many fewer people, perhaps even geographically more specific. There might be an issue here about City Deal in Glasgow and Clyde Valley, where a different kind of deal can be offered to those 8 local authorities. But that's unsatisfactory because in every single part of Scotland, we will find long-term unemployed people and also people who are stuck in low pay and in work poverty who could benefit from a much more ambitious type of offer. So our ability to do that, certainly over the next 5 years, will be constrained, substantially constrained.
Thank you.
No. Okay.
Do you want me to go on to the individual detriment?
Well, or I think, actually we'll come back to that, because okay. That probably, because of all the things we're hearing about, how are we going to manage some of the fluctuations through this, which comes down to the borrowing questions, I think, that Stuart McMillan wanted to ask around. So we'll go there first, and we'll come back to the detriment issue of individuals. Stuart.
Okay, thank you. Certainly, in written evidence provided to the Finance Committee, David Phillips pointed out that the current borrowing is only available to the Scottish Government at present to cover forecast errors of tax revenues. And with the new welfare powers, so clearly they have to be increased. What type of regime do you think should set limits, if any, on borrowing that may be spent on welfare payments?
Borrowing in relation to welfare is not something that is normally thought to be overall good macro policy. borrowing in relation to to invest is the more. Now some spending on welfare may be a form of investment. Difficult to figure that out. The certainly the so-called golden rule around macro fiscal policy rules is around you should be borrowing to invest in the capital stock of the country rather than for current revenues, because there is a danger of ultimately running yourself into borrowing problems. In relation to the welfare powers, they're not the ones that Scotland's got are not really likely to be subject to substantial cyclical fluctuation. They're mostly fairly stable sums of money, so they should be reasonably it should be reasonably easy to forecast them on a year-to-year basis. And therefore, borrowing associated with forecast errors in relation to welfare needn't, it seems to me, be that large.
Precisely because benefits like job seekers' allowance, perhaps housing benefit at the margins, because they are not being devolved. Whatever we think about that decision, the consequences, as David says, the cyclical elements in spending are much, much smaller within the Scottish budget looking ahead. There will be decisions about amount of borrowing and bond issuing, actually, which is an important part of this too. I think that we would say that the debate around there should be much more about investing in the childcare infrastructure, affordable housing supply, which are the kind of drivers of some social security demand. And as far as possible, we want Scotland to be taking control of those longer term drivers and investing in productive activity, which gives us some degree of financial control longer term. So it still is kind of capital spending is where the major drop on borrowing and bond issuing should go, but we could be more creative about how we define productive investment. I think childcare and housing are two good examples of how we could do that.
They fit into the kind of prevention agenda, and you can make the case that you're borrowing now to prevent extra spending in the future. Of course, one of the key issues is how you borrow. In what form do you borrow? Do you borrow on the markets? And then you've got to be concerned about what kind of premium the markets might add, depending on what you say you're borrowing for. Or are you borrowing from the UK government, or effectively through UK government channels, in which case it gets subsumed into a very large chunk of borrowing that's happening each year? Again, that will become clearer when the fiscal framework is published.
I thought that was actually a very interesting answer, particularly regarding the childcare arrangements. Mm-hmm. I hadn't really considered that to be an element of this in terms of the borrowing. Okay, well, thanks.
Linda, you want to kick off on issues to do with individual detriment, and then we'll come to Robin for sort of fiscal consolidation issues.
I'm sure there'll be some other questions about this. It's just the general, and it's one that's been kicking around since the days of the Smith Commission through the Welfare Reform Committee. And here, it's the question of the individual detriment. That, again, what you want to do with the powers you've got, and the ability to give extra income to people, whether it be by new benefits or top-up benefits. I'm not yet convinced that we have bottomed out the issue of not giving with one hand and then it being taken away with the other, because some benefits are means-tested, and then if we're talking about UK government policy on sanctions, and the ability of a Scottish government to be able to give grant to alleviate hardship there. Does that then mean that gets taken back in some other way? Can we assure that there is no individual detriment to households where the government in Scotland would want to either top up existing or give a different kind of benefit?
I hope and believe we have made progress with the last stages of the Scotland Bill in terms of both governments being clearer about what this ought to mean. If you take the example we talked about earlier, if Scotland were to choose to find a way of retaining the value of the work allowance, for example, within universal credit, that's good for work incentives, so it has potentially positive revenue consequences. If we were to do that, it would make absolutely no sense economically, fiscally, in labour market terms, for that benefit to be somehow eroded in other decisions within universal credit. And I think we should pay attention to those kind of shared spaces. So housing flexibilities is a good example, where different areas of Scotland maybe even have different rates of LHA variation. Those concurrent or shared spaces versus fully devolved areas. But in both cases, it's really important that the net benefit is retained, because if you think about it, Scotland would be choosing to invest more or forego more revenue in certain areas. And back to the incentives point, there has to then be an incentive around being able to capture the benefits of that expenditure, for example, in higher employment rates. It's in neither government's interest, actually, to stand in the way of that. But again, right, the point I made right at the start, because we are in uncharted territory, it may be quite important that we do have designed, you know, good enough disputes resolution mechanisms that make sure that the spirit of that individual no detriment is properly adhered to in future.
I just add that we, as Jim says, we don't really know what the consequences of these relative moves might be, and it would be good to have some way of revisiting the situation 5 years hence or whatever. To see to what extent the objectives of the Scottish Government and the objectives of the UK Government have been satisfied within the settlement as currently agreed, and then what kind of variations might be mutually agreed to get the kinds of improved outcomes in Scotland that you want.
Thank you.
You mentioned right at the beginning, I think Jim, it was yourself that mentioned about, I think you both agreed though, the dividing line between major detriment and minor detriment. And some of the major stuff is obviously, you know, can be dealt with, and also stuff that can be dealt with at the point that happens can be easier to calculate the figure then, but the sort of second tier detriments or no detriment issues much more difficult. I mean, have you got a view? What is the difference between, what's the dividing line effectively between major detriment and minor detriment? At what point is it a cash figure you have in mind, or how do you define how it falls into one of these two areas? What should we ignore and what should we not ignore?
I think there are two broad tests. One, the point about proportionality, and it is about impact on global budgets. So the amount of money at stake, plus or minus, as a result of decisions globally or for particular groups in the population who the population exposure might be small, but the impact for those affected might be very large. So that's one route into proportionality. The other thing to look at, I think, over time is where we can get closer to satisfying ourselves that there is a causal connection between a choice made and the impact upon revenues and budgets. That would suggest to me we are kind of crossing the threshold, or, you know, reaching that limit, that level of some kind of measure of detriment. So the only way I think to get into understanding causality is to really try and go after the likely candidates. You can't do this for everything. I would suggest we need to look at suspected major causal effects on both tax and welfare sides, and have an intergovernmental focus on trying to understand what are the causal effects. This is art, not science, and it certainly needs to have enough kind of independent weighing up of the evidence. But this is building the evidence as we go. There is no rule book that tells us where we're going to get to, and it has to be entered into a spirit of negotiation, goodwill as far as possible, but ultimately dispute resolution where necessary.
When you say art, you mean black arts rather than...
No, I mean the more light of transparency we can shed upon these issues, the better. So we will need, Scotland's Fiscal Commission, the OBR, IFS, perhaps others to be in this space. We need to really, bring good expertise to bear. But it's very unpredictable where we get to. I think you can only do this in a few areas over the next 5 years to try and really get at where the big flows might be.
Can I take you back
15 years to the free personal care legislation? And it was then... there were many newspaper headlines around people flooding over the border to take advantage of the much better care provision in Scotland. We didn't know what would happen. Now nobody talks about it at all because it just, as far as we're aware, it didn't happen. But that's sort of just, that's how we didn't know beforehand, but we've learned as time has gone on that isn't a big issue. But, once things do become apparently a big issue, there has to be a mechanism, transparent mechanism, to resolve the issue.
Yep, thank you. Two questions, really. First of all, when you talked about proportionality, we should base it effectively on proportionality. And then you talked about, kind of go after the big stuff. I paraphrase slightly, but obviously I think that's what you're saying. If we're using proportionality as the test, proportionality, the impact on an individual could be extreme, although the relative amount of money would be, it's still part of the budget, would be tiny. So can you maybe just expand a little bit what you mean by proportionality? And the second point, the general point that was being made, was about setting up the kind of independent mechanisms to negotiate and judge this kind of negotiation between the two governments about, on the big stuff, how you define what the impact has been. My question, I suppose, on that is, who guards the guards? I mean, effectively, who checks? What's the resolution process to disputes? Where do you go with that once you've entered into that kind of process?
I'll have a go at the first question, Stuart, on proportionality. So as well as potential global impact on budgets, I think we would want to have some handle on population groups which look as if they are particularly exposed to detrimental consequences of either tax or welfare decisions. I think there will be reasonably good evidence to guide us as to the likely groups which may be most exposed. If you think about changes on tax, which either increase or decrease net household income, for some groups in the population could have a quite major effect on universal credit entitlement, or take a Scottish example, council tax reduction entitlement, or whatever replaces it in future. The kind of crossover points where people are affected or not could be quite fine, so the numbers affected could be quite large or quite small, but we have to have some handle on the likely exposure to risk for those affected groups. Mm. And I think we just have to focus in on where we think the major proportionate impacts are likely to be. But by minor detriment, I'm not suggesting it doesn't matter. I'm just suggesting there may be areas where the net effects of cross-border decisions may net off to close to zero, and we don't need to worry about them long-term too much. We keep an eye on them, but we could put more of our effort into understanding the bigger flows, potentially.
I think, it's impossible to completely micromanage the situation in that there will always be some losers as well as winners if you've got a fixed, broadly fixed budget. But that's the case now. Yeah. It's no different from that now. On mechanisms, I don't think we've really discussed mechanisms enough around dispute resolution. There should really be a set of agreed rules that can't be changed without both parliaments agreeing around how disputes are going to be resolved. And there's also got to be some kind of third party, which is not the Treasury, which has never been a third party, which can take a view on a lot of the issues that we've been discussing, the tax issues, the welfare issues, and so on, and has the respect of both governments and the electorates. Now, that's a tough call. I mean, the OBR is supposed to fit into that role. It's made its way. It's not. I don't think it's fully viewed as fairly or unfairly how it's viewed. It may not be fully thought to be independent. But there isn't anything in train at the minute that seems to me to be around to do these, to set up these rules and to set up this institution. So we'll have to see in part of the fiscal framework, really. But we'll have to see in 3 weeks or so if something like that could be agreed, because stability, it seems to me, would require something that's on both sides is transparent and accepted by both sides.
That's perhaps a very obvious point to make in this company, but as far as possible, you would want to reach, first of all, a political settlement through joint ministerial committee. And if only if that, at that level, we didn't reach good enough agreement, would you go to a more technical form of disputes resolution where both governments would appoint, presumably, representatives to take that forward. But as far as possible, these are fundamentally political decisions about resource allocation, about economic management, and we need to let accountability take its course through politics if possible, and if not, then we need to have a good enough backstop.
Thank you.
Now, I'm just wondering which one of you should be applying for the job for this independent position, because whether it's the tax side or the welfare side, there is no arbitration mechanism, effectively.
No.
And if it isn't in the fiscal framework, are you encouraging us as a committee to make a recommendation that something around that arbitration on both the taxation side and the welfare side should exist?
Yes. I think so, yeah.
Thank you. Just so I got that on the record. So as a supplementary to that,
should the Scottish Fiscal Commission have a role in scrutinising welfare as well as tax forecasts?
The OBR does some forecasting of welfare spend relative to DWP, who also conduct forecasts. And I've forgotten, I think for this paper I used the OBR forecast of welfare spend and not the DWP ones, because the DWP tend to be very optimistic. It's a kind of different type of forecasting all the same, from macroeconomic modelling on the one hand to you know, what's going to be the change in eligibility for a particular part of the population in relation to some welfare benefit. These are two quite different strands of analysis. And whether you should look to setting up a competition for a body to do the forecasting on the welfare side, rather than having a monolith that does tries to do everything, I'm not sure. There's a lot of work done by independent bodies in London around welfare in particular, and health, spending, as well as policy. So there are mechanisms, I think, for building up expertise, and it could be brought within the framework of the Fiscal Commission, but it's a different kind of work.
Rob, I was trained as a geographer, not an economist, so I'm going to be a little bit critical of our economics fraternity in the sense that I think forecasting is subject to, even the best forecasting subject to such large margins of error, especially at times of such uncertainty in public finances. I think it's important that we get as good forecasting as possible, and future finance secretaries and chancellors and parliaments will want to be assured that the information is as good as possible. But the really important point, I think it came out of the last session, is how good the outturn measures and the reconciliation is at the end of financial year, or even if it's over a three-year cycle, getting really accurate information on the actual position on spending and the earlier point about what underlying entitlement is. So we're not losing that point about take-up. Really improving our measurement capacity and comparing that backwards to our forecasting, having the two in tandem, I think, is what's going to improve the position both sides of the border.
So, convener, it means that we've got to have a mechanism to do that in Scotland, even before we come to any potential arbitration between our views and the views in London.
I think there is an interesting question about the relationship between, let's say, the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the OBR, and to what extent, for example, the Scottish Fiscal Commission in its forecast for Scottish income tax takes on board the macro forecast for the UK as a whole, because they're undoubtedly interdependent, that the OBR make. There's no, as far as I know, whether this will even be agreed in the fiscal framework, I don't know. But in a sense, probably you don't want two governmental bodies competing with each other to forecast the UK economy. That's probably not a brilliant idea. But I don't know what the arrangement is going to be.
Yeah. A bit more on fiscal consolidation.
I do indeed, yeah. I mean, you painted a pretty bleak picture, of the available welfare support and Scotland's ability to be flexible over the next 5 years. The command paper, Scotland, the United Kingdom, and Enduring Settlement, states that therefore the fiscal framework must require Scotland to contribute proportionally to the fiscal consolidation at the pace set out by the UK government across devolved and reserved areas. Professor Michael Keating has stated that this appears to go beyond the requirement that any extra expenditure in Scotland be financed by Scottish revenues, which is already covered by the balanced budget requirement. What are your views on this?
Well, I'm not convinced I agree, because increased spending in Scotland financed by increased taxation in Scotland doesn't add to the UK's borrowing. So if you think about the fiscal framework being a deficit target and B, a debt target, and the deficit is intended to be eliminated by 1920, then if Scotland does increased spending that's tax-financed, I'd have thought that doesn't undermine the UK's fiscal targets.
I can't add to that.
Okay.
Being a geographer.
I suspect, of course, it's 2020, not 1920, as you're suggesting.
Sorry, I meant fiscal year 2019 hyphen 20. Sorry, I left out the hyphen.
Yeah, I am reasonably okay with that. But, you know, and also, you know, in the written submission to the Welfare Reform Committee, you did say, David, that you noted a number of benefits being transferred to Scotland fall within the welfare cap. However, the DWP will not be required to account for this spending in the relation to the welfare cap. This is made clear in an enduring settlement document. What is not clear is whether this responsibility will be transferred to the Scottish First Minister. If this responsibility is transferred from the DWP to the Scottish Government, will this impose significant constraints on Scottish policy autonomy? If extra spending is funded by extra taxes raised in Scotland, would the welfare cap still apply? Which is taking it on from the point you just made about...
Yeah, that is a... maybe Jim's better placed than me to comment on that, but that is one part which is not covered by my previous answer and would impose some responsibility in relation to overall fiscal targets. I suppose you could argue that the welfare cap is a means to achieve the ultimate goal, which is the deficit and the debt targets. A transfer of that power, responsibility to Scotland would have an impact on Scotland.
If you look at just benefits being devolved currently covered by the welfare cap, so attendance allowance, carers allowance, DLA PIP, cold weather payments, winter fuel payments, you know, these are not about how you're not shoring up a failing economy by spending money in these areas. These are social investments to largely older people, largely disabled people, or people who lived in very cold parts of the country. So I would suggest that they have a very tenuous, if any, connection to the chance of stewardship of the UK economy overall. I mean, I would also say that both on welfare cap and certainly on the household benefits cap, we're sceptical, not from an ideological perspective, we're sceptical about their effectiveness, and we're sceptical about some of the perverse incentives they build into the system. So of course, you know, controlling spending in these areas is important, but the best way to do that is by tackling the underlying drivers, and that's about unemployment and childcare and housing supply, which are nothing to do with the bulk of welfare cap.
Thank you.
I can't answer whether it will happen, but our view would be it shouldn't.
Well, thank you. I think that brings us to an end of what I think has been a fascinating evidence session taken, actually, and given us a lot of food for thought. Probably begged as many questions as it's answered in my own head, actually, if the truth be told. But can I thank both witnesses for coming along today? It's been very helpful, and thank you for giving us your time. That, though, I want to just move straight into agenda item 2, which is an opportunity for the committee to consider recent and forthcoming work by other parliamentary committees on issues raised by the provisions in the Scotland Bill. Attached to the paper is a report from the Local Government Regeneration Committee on fixed odds betting terminals, a copy of the letter for convener of standards and procedures, public appointments and committee on supermajorities and powers to amend the Scotland Act. Additionally, information that the Infrastructure Capital Investment Committee is planning an evidence session on Ofcom. And finally, we know we're going to be getting some correspondence from the Rural Affairs, Climate Change, Environment Committee on its further work on the transfer scheme for the Crown Estate. I don't know if members have got any comments, but what I would suggest is that today we note these, and we'll obviously, in terms of their content, we need to use these as part of our consideration of our report in due course. Stuart?
No, I agree with that, Convener, but I would just like to put on the record that I think the work of the Local Government Regeneration Committee on the fix of asbestos terminals, a piece of work that they undertook, I thought was excellent, and they certainly went into all the issues, and I want to commend them for it on the record.
Okay, that's on the record. Any other points at this stage, or are we happy to note and consider as part of a report? Okay, that's agreed, thank you. Before moving into private session, I should add that the committee will meet again next week, when we'll take evidence from a panel of witnesses on the issues of post-study work visas and discuss the report on a recent fact-finding visit to Spain. And I now move this meeting of the committee into private session.